Good afternoon. My name is Frank Key, and this is Hooting Yard on the Air on Resonance 104.4 FM. Today, it's of decisive importance that I tell you about Blodgett-esque farming methods. The techniques pioneered by Blodgett in his heyday are breathtaking. Consider, for example, the uses to which a Blodgettian farmer will put hay. There are many, many diagrams in the manual which show bales of hay being commandeered for all sorts of inventive purposes, all over the farmyard, in all six seasons of the year. That's right, six seasons. One of Blodgett's most telling innovations was his calendrical recalibration, if I'm using the word correctly. Out go winter, spring, summer and autumn. In come tally, spate, the time of mighty remonstrations, tack, hub and bilismus. So, come hub, come the haywain, as the saying goes, with his big fat boots stuffed with straw. I mean, hay. We ought not get diverted from this important essay by wandering down the byways of Blodgettian countryside parlance, but I can't resist sharing with you the rhyme that goes, "Don't forget to shut the gate on the 43rd of spate." The meaning of which is obvious, as you would realise had you seen, as I have, an implacable army of albino hens marching off into the sunset because little Vercingetorix, the barnyard hobbledehoy, was too busy chewing on a sheaf of fronds to remember to close the gate behind him. As it happened, the fronds were poisonous, and the miscreant was subject to convulsive fits for the next 3 weeks, bless him. As with hay, so with mulch. Blodgett-esque mulch is a thing of beauty, even if it does stink. Have you ever seen asparagus grown in Blodgett's mulch? You would remember if you had, for it is to common everyday asparagus as a big, shiny, supersonic 26th century space rocket is to a shred of plankton. Preparation of mulch takes place mostly in bilismus, when the winds howl and thunderclaps shatter the eardrums of toiling farm workers, hardy folk with almost inhuman musculature as a result of regular doses of Blodgett's serum, the recipe for which appears in an appendix to the manual. To begin farming the Blodgett way, all you will need is a hoe, a shapeless hat, iron determination, and your own field, preferably one with a pond in it, and ducks in the pond, merganses or teal, some of them real, some of them wood-carved decoy ducks, and some of them just vaporous spectres of your own fervent imagining. This is an extract from the autobiography of Mrs. Gubbins, which she has been writing, and I crept into her office the other day and stole a few pages of the manuscript. So here's part of Mrs. Gubbins' autobiography. After my divorce from the man who liked to sing Shenandoah morning, noon and night, setting my teeth on edge, I became a flapper and spent the next 5 years going from one party to another. I doubt that any of the demi-mondaines with whom I canoodled had any idea that between parties I was lecturing at various colleges on the history of bell ringing and the doctrine of transubstantiation in the Tudor Church. It was through this shared interest that I met Ah Fang, who became husband number two. "Bathsheba," he would say to me, "I often wonder why my parents named me Ah Fang. After all, my father was Belgian and my mother hailed from the tenebrous, dense forests of northern Finland. My siblings all have names like Jan and Joost and Haki and Aino Johani." "How many siblings have you got, Ah Fang, my sweet?" I would ask, pecking him on the cheek. Then his brow would grow furrowed, and he would become morose, and mutter something about going out to buy a bottle of dandelion and burdock. I became unhappy at this secretiveness of his, and it grieves me to think that during our 8 months together, I felt closer to my pet anteater, Desmondo. Nonetheless, I wept for a week when Ah Fang perished in the Hindenburg disaster. I owe my life to the fact that for once I was not at his side that day, having in that very week been employed to spy on the young Anthony Burgess, or John Wilson as he then was, for reasons I forget. I must say it rains a lot in Lancashire. That was the only extract I've so far got of Mrs. Gubbins' autobiography. But the brief paragraph that I've just read about scarcely does justice to Ah Fang, for he was an endlessly fascinating man with a brain the size of an airship, such as that in which he perished. In his memoir, The Ah Fang I Knew, F.X. Duggleby wrote as follows. Ah Fang harboured certain ideas about phosphorescence, parallelograms, and the life cycle of the funnel web spider, which challenged the Weltanschauung, or at least my Weltanschauung. He often likened his curiosity about the world to a raven regurgitating food for its young, although it's difficult to grasp quite what he meant by this analogy. Much given to solitude, he would lie for hours in a tin bath, paring his fingernails insouciantly and humming what he called the true music of the spheres. At other times, such as cocktail parties, he would start up an unearthly keening, pressing a medicine ball to his chest. Fluent in Flemish and Finnish, he was surprisingly inarticulate in such exciting languages as Wendish or Sorbian, Sea Dayak, Pedi, Pangwa, Petit Mauresque, and Micmac. His widow Bathsheba once calculated that Ah Fang devised over 400 distinct recipes for cold soup, despite an abnormality of the taste buds which had afflicted him since a childhood accident in a meadow on a Wednesday, with a blowtorch, in a frenzy. Duggleby, who that quote was from, appears to be mistaken regarding Ah Fang's cocktail party behaviour, for the man who so nearly became Pope, Giordano Sforza, left a vivid account of a bash one night on the outskirts of the Vatican in 1923, which reads as follows. Ah Fang, brilliantined and slobbering, entered the room. I could see that his airship-sized brain was pulsating more terrifically than it usually did. I could see this because, like Ray Milland, I was the man with X-ray eyes. I have always said that my special gift cost me the papacy, but this is not the time to bemoan my slow decline into beggardom, penury and insignificance. No, in those days I struck a fine figure as the confidant of such men as Ah Fang. His presence filled the room, despite all those glittering chandeliers and the expensive furniture. He spoke but briefly in an aside to some foreign ambassador of preening contemptibility, and I was unable to hear exactly what he said. He spent most of the evening leaning against a harp, steadily devouring pies and enchanting a number of floozies with the enigmatically mute braggadocio of his flim-flam. Ah Fang's greatest legacy may well be the dredging of the canal at Garg on the eve of the Batcake Aikido conference, a full account of which can be found in Dobson's pamphlet The Dredging of the Canal at Garg on the eve of the Batcake Aikido conference, out of print. I want to try an experimental radio thought wave process, because the next piece I want to read depends on two photographs. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold the photograph up, maybe flap it a bit, and see if my brain waves can go across the ether, so you'll be able to sense them. It's basically, here at Hooting Yard, we're always seeking new ways to help our readers achieve self-actualization in the profoundest sense. To this end, we commissioned Professor Zoltan Shuddery to devise a quiz based on his theory that all known human personality types can be shoehorned into two basic eidolons. Eidolon from the Greek means a spectre or phantom, which suggests that the professor knows not of what he speaks. But it can also mean an idealized image, the sense in which it was sometimes used in the early 19th century. So perhaps that's what he's driving at. Anyway, each of us, Shuddery argues, is either a Richard Milhouse Nixon or an Emily Dickinson. So try the quiz to see which model you fit into. The first question, so listen carefully, you may want a pen and paper to note down your answer. 1. Do you like to spend long hours gazing wistfully out of an upstairs window in Amherst? The second question, given the chance, would you bomb Cambodia? And the third question, and this is where I'm going to try and send a kind of sensory picture of the photographs. I want you to look very, very carefully at these two photographs, randomly generated photographs, and assuming you were invited to share a picnic with one of these people, would it be person A or person B? So, this is the first one. So, that's person A. I'm getting a sense of, I don't know, getting a sense of a quiet New England town, perhaps some poems being written. And this is person B. Okay, that's, I've just waved that other photograph. I'm getting the sense there of, I don't know, someone involved in six crises, perhaps with a small dog called Checkers. So, those are the three questions to answer. When you've completed the quiz, send your answers for analysis to Professor Zoltan Shuddery at the usual address, marked Who Am I? He will send you a report of no less than 14 closely typed pages, individually tailored, to give you a deep and lasting insight into your personality, indeed, into your very essence. Ugo turns blue. It was St. Hector's Day in the old town of Plovdiv. Ugo's hood got snagged on a tack and he had turned blue, or, as Carl Sagan used to say, blue. Ooh, said Ugo's pal Ulf. Ugo, you look all blue. Ack, said Ugo. I'll go and fetch your blind ma, Ugo, to see what she can do, said Ulf, though he could have pulled Ugo's hood off the tack on which it was snagged. But Ulf had been sniffing glue. Ulf found Ugo's ma sitting on a stool. Ugo's ma, said Ulf, Ugo has turned blue. His hood is snagged on a tack. Ugo's ma was eating a chew, but she jumped off her stool and ran to Ugo, who was indeed very blue. Ugo's ma spat out her chew, and it landed in a pot of glue. It was the glue Ugo's pal Ulf had been sniffing. Ugo's ma unsnagged Ugo's hood from the tack. "Ack," said Ugo. "Ooh, Ugo's ma, I knew you would know what to do," said Ulf. Ugo's ma clouted Ulf on the head with a spoon and confiscated his glue. Ugo went off to find his shoes. It was time for Mass at St. Hector's Cathedral in Plovdiv. I just thought I would mention, you know that the Sherlock Holmes stories were, that Conan Doyle wrote them as if they were written by Dr. Watson. It was Dr. Watson, retailing the various cases. And quite often in the stories, Dr. Watson, in an aside almost, mentions other cases that he's never written up. So there's like, there's the corpus of the Sherlock Holmes stories, and then there's this kind of ghost set of all these cases that Watson mentions but never writes up. Some of them sound really fascinating. One of them that I remember, I can't remember which story it's from, is the affair of the bogus laundry. And my absolute favourite is which for fairly obvious reasons is from the story entitled The Adventure of the Naval Treaty. And I'd just like to quote from this. And I think that the case that Dr. Watson refers to here really ought to be written up. Maybe I should write it myself. This is Conan Doyle or Dr. Watson. "The discretion and high sense of professional honour which have always distinguished my friend are still at work in the choice of these memoirs, and no confidence will be abused. I deprecate, however, in the strongest way the attempts which have been made lately to get at and to destroy these papers. The source of these outrages is known, and if they are repeated, I have Mr. Holmes' authority for saying that the whole story concerning the politician, the lighthouse, and the trained cormorant will be given to the public. There is at least one reader who will understand." Don't you just love that? The adventure of the politician, the lighthouse, and the trained cormorant. It's such a shame he never wrote it. Do bees make moral choices? Do bees know the difference between good and evil? Answering these questions was the life's work of Captain Federico Gull, pirate-turned-apiarist, the man who swapped a life being roguish and dastardly on the high seas for one spent limping around on his wooden leg among hundreds of beehives in a field. Captain Gull had been possibly the most feared buccaneer on the Spanish Main, or what was left of it. He was so fierce that he would eat a mouthful of carpet tacks for breakfast, washed down with the blood of various animals penned in the cargo hold, which he slaughtered with his sharp and shiny scimitar. Unlike the general run of pirates, however, he rarely cackled. Indeed, he was not given to laughter, hideous or otherwise. Underneath the terrifying exterior, he was a thoughtful fellow, whose pleasures were found not in fighting and carousing, but in resting on his bunk with a good book, such as The Rule of St. Benedict, in his cabin strewn with the blossom of fragrant shrubs. Only when there was a rustle in the piles of blossom, and his Lovecraftian Shoggoth reared its terrible head and prodded him to bloodlust, did Captain Gull become violent. Sometimes he wondered what had become of the rest of his crew, for there was not a soul else on board his ship. It was in mulling over the inconsistencies of his own behaviour that Captain Gull began to think about the ideal of the good bee. As luck would have it, one winter's day a huge storm engulfed the ship, and it was run aground on a remote island, but not before the Lovecraftian Shoggoth had been hurled overboard by the mighty tempest. Alone at last, Captain Gull clumped ashore, drenched and disconcerted, and camped overnight in a field. Next morning, exploring his new home, he discovered that the island was riddled with swarms of bees. The rest, children, is history. And that's taken from a pamphlet by Dobson entitled The Bee as Moral Exemplar and Other Insect-Related Parables for Young and Old Alike, in it. Making hats out of wood. The craft of making wooden hats is the subject of a children's activity weekend to be held at Bodger's Spinney next month. We're predicting excessively foul weather, so make sure your tiny tots are wrapped up warm. They will also need to wear special boots because the violent magnetic activity which has been throbbing in the spinney since Mr. Poxhaven overturned a jar of his experimental substance. The Hooting Yard Emergency Response Squadron managed to seal off part of the area, but they used plywood for their impromptu fence, and during the night it tends to get gnawed at by voles. This intelligence has been reported by the Pang Hill Vole Watching Club, who camp out by the spinney night after night, peering through binoculars and scribbling notes on sheets of A2 paper, which they pin up each morning on that board outside the post office. We should be thankful to every last man jack of them. At the Festival of Bears and Pomposity in December, they will be given a special prize made out of tin in recognition of their efforts. Tickets for the children's activity weekend are available from that weird dilapidated kiosk over by the pond. Bring your own planks. The 400 men and women of the Blister Lane Cormorant Patrol brandished their pencil sharpeners, toffee apples, and inaccurate atlases as they reached the peak of the tour after marching all day. Below them, beyond the pig huts, the curiously stained bridge, and the abandoned swimming baths, they were just able to see, shrouded in mist, the famous or infamous Wotan and Tantalum ponds, so dried up after successive droughts that they were now little more than puddles. "Onwards!" cried Captain Federico Gwyneth Paltrow, undisputed leader of the Cormorant Patrol, and the man whose stupendous energy had helped it thrive, even through such lean times. Seldom has a puny and diminutive physiognomy been so misleading. And so began their descent. Three-quarters of the way down, the newest recruit, Fay Young Daisy Ricardo Montalban, stopped in her tracks, pointed, and yelled out, "Look! Look! Something with a beak and feathers!" And indeed, as they peered through the enshrouding mist, the others saw it too, perched on the branch of a withered pugton tree, sprouting hopelessly on the banks of one of the ponds, or puddles. Excitedly, they began running, capering and gamboling down the muddy slope of the tor. But as they closed upon their prey, they realised it was not a cormorant at all. It was a little bittern. And the source of that story is from an anonymous book entitled 46 Bird-Related Adventure Stories. I very rarely read poetry. I very rarely write poetry, but I very rarely read poetry on this show. But I'd like to read a little poem to you now. Matt spat in the pan. He was a dismal man. He ate his whey and curds and went to look for birds. He found a curlew first. He spat again and cursed. Then he saw a crow pecking a lump of dough. Then linnets, geese, a chough, until he'd seen enough. Matt trudged into his shed, an inferno in his head. He wept and drooled and shook. Then, in his exercise book, he wrote with trembling pen that he had not seen the hen. The hen that made him scream when it loomed awful in his dream. That plagued him every night, the hen of hideous white. The weird, ferocious bird squawking the terrible word. The word that drove Matt mad. The word Ack-Brack-A-Blad. And that's why I rarely read poetry. But I hope you enjoyed it. Nearly time for the show to end. I just thought I'd bring your attention to some new films due for release soon. There's The Stepford Hives, ecological horror about a swarm of brainwashed bees. Where Bee Girls Dare, a crack squad of floozies storms a Nazi fortress. Apocalypse Cow, drug-crazed American soldiers going crazy in a barnyard. The Wild Bench, an action picture set in a municipal park. Quatermass and the Git, sci-fi classic in which a sordid old man is found buried in a London underground station. The Hound of Music, an Austrian singing dog drama. And finally, Bring Me the Shed of Alfredo Garcia, a violent revenge thriller set in a garden centre. And that's all we have time for on Hooting Yard this week. Remember, you can visit the website at http://hooting.yard.users.btopenworld.com. So pay a visit to the website, take a packed lunch, and I'll be back next week with more deeply moving prose to bring you to tears. Bye.